God be the glory for all that he says and he's done, that he said to us and that he's done for us. We bless the living Savior on this morning, this Easter morning. Oh, how he loves us. We thank God for, again, the opportunity to share with you one and all for this special and glorious occasion. We want to say good morning to everyone who has joined in and signed on. And I want to say a special, hey, man, good morning to the IHICM family. Boy, do we miss you. But we give God the praise, for he is still covering us regardless of what may be going on. Amen. Well, I'm excited about the day, and I give God the praise, for he is so worthy, and he is, amen, so worthy of all the praise and the honor. As a matter of fact, I was listening at a song, and it says that before I even spoke a word, that he was singing over me. Before I took a breath, he breathed inside of me, and he breathed inside of you. He says that he has an overwhelming and never-ending reckless love for us. It chases us and gets us into the right position. It says, even when we were his foe, he continued to love on us and he fought for us. And for that reason, and that reason alone, we ask God now to fill us till we overflow, to fill us so that we might be able to run for him. Gracious Father, we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. And we thank you for keeping us and giving us a waking up this morning and continue to have breath in our body. Father, we love you and we praise you. And for that, we give you all the glory as we celebrate you on this Easter Sunday. Amen. Look, I was just thinking, and as I was meditating this week on the word, trying to find out what it was the Lord would have me to say to you. And I first had to come to the realization that he wanted to talk to me. I would look out the window, and I would say, as I say many times as I'm working, and I see one thing, that the Lord is still being God outside. And because of this thing inside of me, I want to get out in it. And so I'm sitting there and I'm asking God, and I'm hearing his word about he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And I'm saying, God, well, help me with this. Help me understand. Help me so that I might partake of this day and be glad in it, that I might rejoice in it. In other words, I was saying, God, I want to go outside. And I begin to fight and continue to fight the temptation to go somewhere and, you know, trying to do what the government is saying, doing, resisting those temptations of disobedience, as I pray we all are down. So you got to tear down that spirit of movement sometime. Amen. And again, I would focus back and forth on God and how good he's been. And I ask God, what do you want me to say today? Because I'm kind of struggling with it. I was about to, amen, minister a word about I'm coming out. And God said, no, you won't. He said, but God, listen, I'm trying to figure out what to do here, because we realize that this is a day that has everything to do with the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it being the foundation of Christian faith. And we realize that without the resurrection, the belief in God would have no saving grace. Amen. And because of that, we need to think about him. We got to realize that Jesus rose from the dead, and that it confirms his identity as the Son of God. We got to realize that his work of atonement, his work of redemption, reconciliation, and salvation is very important. We got to realize that the resurrection is real. It's literally a physical raising of Jesus Christ for the body, from the body, for the dead of sin in us. And I just kept asking God, and all I kept hearing was, remove from tradition. I need you to remove from tradition. God kept telling me this is not an average Easter. So I kept crying out to the Lord about how I felt. And I asked him, I said, God, lead me to your word. Guide me to the place of where you would have me to minister to your people and to minister to me, because I need a word from you today. And I don't want it to be just regular. And God kept carrying me back. And I know it was God, because it was not in my mind to do it. And he kept carrying me to Psalms, the 8th Psalm, verse 4. What is man that thou art mindful of him? And I kept thinking about these words. And before I know it, God said, hold it. You're saying that you're trying to go by what I'm saying, but what you're doing is talking around me. He said, you haven't talked to me yet. And he said, let's have a conversation. And my brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, it's a time when we need to just shut down and talk to God. Not talk about what he promised us right now, but to talk to him. So God asked me, he said, tell me about yourself. And I was reminded of the scripture saying that let a man first examine himself when you're entering into covenant. And I begin to realize that this was one of those times. And so I begin to talk to God, even though I realize I'm like, he already knows who I am. And it's backed up by scripture in Isaiah, the 44th chapter. It says, thus saith the Lord, that made thee and formed thee from the womb. So I know who God is, and I know that God knows who I am. But for some reason, he's asking me this rhetorical question to tell him about me. See, it's important in this season of time that we know who we are. So we know what we're using to base our realizations and our revelations about God from. So I begin to tell God because I feel like I'm being trapped for a lot of reasons. I'm trapped between what man wants, what family wants, what my faith is saying, and I'm trying to just figure out, just where I am in this. So when he asked me, I begin to say, God, you know, as a young man, I was never afraid of the fight. Mm-hmm. I never started a fight, but I was always ready. And God, I'm saying right now to me, I'm ready for this fight. I'm not afraid. I realize it's bigger, it's greater than me. It's all about you. He reminded me that as a young man, I was always a man of peace, a peaceful child. And then something happened in my life one day. I remember it well. I was a young man, and I was just minding my business, and this set of twins, now follow me now. I'm earning my little dollars and cents, and you got to think about back on the things that have formed you as a child. And you use those things and grew out of those things. And I remembered this, and I wasn't always fighting. I was really peaceful. I would really just rather not fight. Somebody say amen. And a lot of times we're running into that right now. Amen. So I went on. I said, God, you remember I was just minding my business. Mm-hmm. And this set of twins came and took my money, my little earnings, my little pennies. And they would do this. And it seemed like they were waiting for me all the time. Don't you know trouble is always going to wait for you at that place where you have not governed yourself properly in the things of God? And I recall this old friend that was there. He almost became my brother-in-law. But he told me this. He said, this will continue to happen if you don't begin to fight for yourself. I'm still going somewhere. And I begin to realize this truth. And, of course, the next time I saw them, I fought and I remained with my money. Somebody say amen. So this experience solidified my resistance to fight. But I toggle between peace and fighting. And that's always been one of my struggles, when to turn it on and when to turn it off. See, there are some things that we have to realize that have hindered us in our growth process. And I begin to meditate because I thought for all of my life that fighting spirit in the body of Christ translated to faith. And God began to talk to me about that because I was wondering, is it my faith that moves me? Or is it really the fear of failure? And I fight to keep what I got, what man has afforded me. And God said, watch this. He said, I told you then. I saw you then. He said, I saw you as you grew up. And how you begin to fight to be a good man, a good father, a good son, husband, and friend. He said, I saw you in the garden of life retreating to hide from the fears of failure that moved you to a place where I could transform, amen, that fear into faith. And you've hung on to that. And now you continue to fight for that. But my brothers and sisters, I want you to know, watch this, that God showed me something, that I no longer was fighting against those twins, and that he was with me all the time. And I again heard the scripture in my spirit, and it said, what is man that God is mindful of him? And it was then that God gave me the message to tell you. God wants you to know that he has always had you on his mind. He tells us that he would never leave nor forsake us, that he would be with us until the end of the earth. He said, that is why I sent my son, that those that believeth on him would not perish. He said, that's because I loved you so much. You were always and are always on my mind. I sacrificed my only begotten son, sent him into this world, not to condemn it, not with all of our failures, our disappointments, not for that reason. I sent him that you might be saved. And God began to minister to me, and he said, that's why I was there when Nicodemus was talked to. That's why I told him that lest a man be born again, he cannot see God. Because I was there, and I had him on my mind. God said, this Easter message is, that's why I took the journey to the cross. That's why I went through all of the beatings, all of the people that I came to save leaving me, all of the distrust and the treason, because I had you on my mind. I begin to get excited about God. I begin to have something stir up inside of me. And I realized that this truly was no average Easter. Why? Because God, watch this, God took back the Holy Week celebration. God marked time with the holiest of times. Times when people flock to the church, but too much of what they leave with is tradition. Too much of what they hear is out of the intellect of man as he interprets scripture for itchy ears. God said, I did not go to the grave just for tradition, especially not man's tradition. He said, that's why, because you were on my mind, Melvin. And whoever you are today looking in this camera, he said, because I had you on my mind. What kind of man are you? One that God loves, one that he cares about. Does not matter what's going on. He said, I rested in the grave. Somebody needs to hear this. All that he went through, being spat on, being hung on a cross, between what we consider two thieves when really they were two souls that God was still reaching out to. He said, that's why I went, because I had them on my mind. My beloved, when you get up today and you begin to hear messages, he said, this is why the stone was removed, so that you could see that God is God and God is all by himself. That's why I kept my promise and I got up on this morning. Not for tradition, not for intellect, but so that we could grab a hold to through every trial and tribulation. He said, have I not said that man's life will be filled with trials and tribulation? God said that he's trying to tell us that the preparation of living in the kingdom of God requires us to first of all believe. He said, why? Because that's why I have you on my mind. He said, that's why I look death in the face and told it, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Why? Because I had you on my mind. Even when I'm going through these things, it's because of you. And I begin to praise God, and I begin to realize that there are some things that we are dealing with. But look at it at this time, beloved. Man can't do anything to God. So God took back, I remember, I can hear Jesus in his journey say, you don't take my life, I give it to you. God is saying, no man can pick what goes on during my season. And it's still my season. He could have used any time he wanted. But he's speaking a message now to the body of Christ that we might come to the realization that God still has purpose for us. And that in these times that God is yet still in control. He says, and I might realize that even though I've said to you that I would never leave nor forsake you, that some of us still are dealing with a spirit of doubt. But God showed us something during this season. One that walked with him, his son Jesus, is really known as an inspiration for our doubt and the recovery and reconciliation with ourselves. The Bible tells us in John, the 20th chapter, verse 26, he says, after 8 days again, his disciples, watch this, once again, in other words, God has already showed himself to you many times, and you clung to his purpose, but for some reason, the memory is inadequate, and our faith is being shook, and our thoughts are being misdirected, and our fears are reshaping us. And the Bible tells us it's our reasonable service to love him and present ourselves holy to God. He said, and while we're in this world, we cannot be trends. We cannot take on the form of the world. And we got to realize, beloved, the kingdom of God cannot look at this as the world does. God is telling us that he has no respect to person. It's happening in the church. It's happening in the hospitals. It's happening in the prisons. It's happening, watch this, in the police department. It's happening in the schools. It's happening walking down the street. It's happening everywhere. Why? Because God is trying to get our attention. We don't know where it came from. Some people are arguing, well, did God send it or is he allowing it? My brothers and my sisters, understand this. It don't matter. What matters is that the situation that we're in, God still has control. And God still has us on his mind. He's never taken us off of his mind. We are continuously on God's prayer list. Watch this disciple. It said, 8 days they came together. And watch this. For the purpose of our understanding, God inspired this word to be wrote as such. He said, and Thomas, one of the disciples, one of the ones walking with him, what is God saying? I realize that some of you are real close, that you love me. This ain't a question of love. He said, some of us are committing spiritual adultery as it relates to our faith. We're allowing doubt to slip in. And it's all right, watch this. We don't know what's happening. God understands it. But are you standing on his word? Watch this. God is doing everything and has done everything that he says. And one of his disciples, who I don't remember his name being mentioned until this part, unless it's the time when he was called into discipleship. Somebody hear me now. There's been some times in your life when you think you may not have been getting noticed, but God is telling you right now, beloved, that you have still always been on his mind. So he says, watch this. Jesus came after they were there. Hear me. Sometimes God is not going to show up for us because we don't believe it until something happens. Mm-hmm. So the Bible tells us, amen. Watch this. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut in the midst of restriction. Somebody say amen. In the midst of us retreating, in the midst of the disciples gathering, amen. Jesus came and he stood in the midst. Oh my God. My beloved, I just stopped by to tell you that Jesus is standing in the midst of all that's going on. None of this is getting by him. And he told me to tell you, beloved, peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Rest in this time of unknowing. The same way he rested in the grave. This ain't the end. Oh my God, it's really a new beginning. And he said to Thomas, because God will allow individual blessings to occur in the midst of corporate blessings. So he pulled Thomas out of his position of doubt. And he's reaching out for somebody right now. And he's telling us the thing that you feel with, glory be to God, your house, your car, your children, your job, your church. He said, take that thing and behold my hand. In other words, he said, reach to me with that thing that you're considering worth, watch this, you losing your faith to hold on to. Oh God, I still hear me fighting with those twins. I was ready to risk everything to keep what I had gained in my little work. And God said, thrust it in my side. Oh, glory be to God. He said, take that thing that you are holding on to, that you're trusting the much. Because see, Thomas, he was always looking for feeling, but his doubt was keeping him from feeling it. Oh my God, what am I saying? Many of us are looking for God and God is standing right in our midst, but we aren't paying attention. We're looking for God now and we can't see him because of our posture is not in faith. He said, thrust it in my side, hear me, and be not faithless. Beloved, God is saying, take that situation, give it to me, but give it to me in faith and believing. Seeing God is looking for us to come to the same place that Thomas came to. God is looking to us to reach out to him now and answer him as he calls to us in a spirit of peace, hollering out, my Lord, my God. God is looking for us to surrender to him on an individual basis at this time. You can only do this by yourself. God told me to tell you, say, don't worry about the doubting. I'm aware of what's happening. Let me handle the storm. Come here, Matthew, the 14th chapter. He said, when the wind was boisterous and we may be afraid, it may look like we're about to sink. And at this point, watch this, we, in the body of Christ, we in the world that don't even know him. Now we're saying, Lord, save me. But God is a righteous God. God is a holy God. And I just want to tell you right now, because you're on his mind, God told me to tell you that immediately when you surrender to him during this season, when you give him control, when you walk in faith, when you begin to build up a resistance to what's going on in the world. I remember the songwriter sung it like this once. The world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it. When you begin to realize that you did not get these things on your own, but it was God in his mercy that allowed you to have whatever it is you have. He said immediately, Jesus says he's going to stretch forth his hand, and he's going to catch you, and he's going to ask you. My brothers and sisters, it's a time for honesty. He's going to ask you, why did you doubt me? Do you have to wait for the wind to cease? Oh, my God. I just came here to tell you that if you seek him, you will see him. And the wind will cease. As a matter of fact, and when you get to that point, Matthew, the 28th chapter tells us, when you come to this place, when you come to your Galilee, when you go up in the mountain where Jesus is, when you go to that high place where God is, where you realize where God is doing his appointing, you've got to come to the realization that you got to go worshiping him. I'm looking forward to the day when we come back to church. Glory be to God. I'm excited. I miss it. I was told the other day it's been almost a month. Man, I feel like a deer panting, wanting the word of the Lord to rest on me, the praise and the worship of the saints, the coming together. But watch this. He said, when you worship me, you'll begin to realize that when I came back, I didn't just come back. Don't deal with me through tradition. Deal with me through the realization that my coming back with me came all power, and it was given to me under heaven and in the earth. Yes, I realize there's some words that we're being confronted with constantly. These words bring nothing but fear. They bring nothing that speaks of anything other than destruction. And at the real reality of all of this in our minds, we're trying to figure out, is my number being called during this season? My brothers and sisters, I know there's them mites, them demics, an epidemic that is a graduated place from an outbreak. You know when stuff get bad, when they start carrying it to different levels? Because see, the different levels bring a different amount of fear. And the body of Christ, it should be bringing a different amount of faith. Watch this. The outbreak turns into the epidemic. And the epidemic turns into the pandemic. But God told me to go to Isaiah, the 6th chapter. He said, in the year that King Isaiah died, I saw the Lord, watch this, sitting on his throne. God told me to tell you that during this season, some sickness is going to die. Some sadness is going to die. Some loneliness is about to die. And from that's going to become a people that realize that God is sending righteousness where religiosity was. Glory be to God. He's speaking to the church. He says, listen, and he's asking us, who shall I send? Who will go for us? I don't know about you, but I'm tired of dealing with my problems. Because when I deal with my problems, and that's something I try not to do, but the one thing that happened, I guess God got to wrought this thing to me properly so I understand and that I cannot hide behind what I think is faith. I need to get to the place where it's really faith so I can stand on it without even thinking about any destruction coming my way. I got to realize that what he said in Exodus, when he said, put the blood on the post that my house is covered. I got to come to the place where I only see God. Why? Because there's another demic, and ain't nobody speaking about this one, and it's called an endemic. That's the thing that happens when a particular people or group, glory be to God, when the kingdom of God comes together and stands together for righteousness, not foolishness, not tradition, but for God and God alone. When we get to the place where no matter what's going on in our lives, we can stand on the rooftops and holler out, "Thou art the Christ." I don't care what others are saying. When the time comes for me to answer that question, I can say, "Thou art the Christ." Why? Because even in that, God is blessing. And now while some things may be going on, my beloved, we got to really take inventory. Because in the midst of this, God is still blessing. Some of us still have our jobs. There's some folk that complaining about the stimulus package. I thank God for those that are getting the stimulus package. And I also thank God for the fact that I don't need it. Can I dance for a minute? Some of us, we ain't dancing right because we don't realize that God has exalted us so much that you don't even need that. He's asking you to stand on what I've already done for you. He says in Philippians 2, "Fulfill my joy." God said, "I've always had you on my mind. Don't just have me on your mind when you need me. Don't just have me on your mind for tradition. Don't just have me on your mind for religious purposes on Sunday and you come and serve or sit in your office." God is saying your office, and I'm trying to show you right now, it's bigger than the building that you're in. What I put inside of you needs to explode out into the world. Come on, somebody. God is saying, "Fulfill my joy. Be on one accord. Have one mind." I know it's going to get rough sometime. Do you remember in my last portions of my journey, as I sat in the Garden of Gethsemane, I spoke out to God and I said, "God, if you can read, but watch this." He says, "I know from time to time, this is too much of a burden to bear. People judging you, folk ain't walking with you, friends leaving you, disappointments confronting you." God is saying, "I need my church. I need my church to say, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." God is asking us, glory be to God, to go a little further. He says, not only am I God that has you on my mind, he says, am I truly on your mind? I come to the realization that while I may want to go out, what's important is what's in. And I come to the realization that who I am is because of God. In other words, it's because of him that I have my being. So God began to minister to me after I got myself straight. Somebody say amen. I had to come to myself and realize that even though I'm standing in and behind faith, even though I'm standing behind the promises of God, even though my testimony rings strong, even though God uses me from time to time, I still have to suffer sometimes. Come on, somebody. God is saying, what decision will you make in this time of trouble? Is my son's coming more important than just a Sunday when you can dress up? What about the journey? What about the time in the grave? Will you sacrifice yourself and rest in your sacrifice? God told me, he said, stand on your watch. In other words, church, do what I've called you to do. He said, sit in the tower. Be seen. Don't be just sitting at the bottom. Get up. Show somebody your faith. Be anxious to see what God is going to say when he gets ready to say it. And then it became clear to me something that the Speaker of the House said this week. She said, in the midst of all these troubles, and I just want to paraphrase and use that for believers. She said, when trials come, we don't agonize, we organize. God wants to know who's going to become a part of the true kingdom of God? Who's going to be used to be organized to continue to carry this word out that the world can see? This ain't new to God. I think about Sodom and Gomorrah, not only when the Israelites were being freed, but when God said, is there any holy men? Oh, glory to God, in the world at this time. That's why this thing is touching everywhere. This ain't got nothing to do with color. It ain't got nothing to do with denomination. As a matter of fact, I think the Catholic Church is the biggest church in the land. But even the Pope had to talk to nobody but the Lord on this Sunday morning. Come on, somebody. God is trying to tell us it's those little conversations, those intimate conversations about him, that really, when he's being lifted up purely, that folk are drawn towards him. So God said, I need you at this time to, my grandbaby, the youngest one, it blessed my soul because it was funny, but it was life-filling, life-changing. She was doing something one day during this period of time, and her mother was trying to get her to settle down. And this little girl, this little three-year-old girl, looked up at this adult, her mother, and she said, relax and calm. Oh, glory be to God. God is saying, relax and calm. He says, seek me. Don't worry about this setback, because it's really a setup. In other words, smell the coffee. You got to come to the realization, as David did when he wrote this song. And I begin to really understand what God was saying to us. In the midst of these trials, watch this. David, if you allow me to paraphrase just a little bit. Here's David. He's laying on his spiritual back. He's looking up into the heavens. He's laying in the grass in a childlike manner. God is telling us we got to come back to him as a child. Not with our intellect, but with our hearts. We got to come as a child and pay attention to what it is that he says. And David, he was postured. Watch this. Even though it hadn't come yet, it was still in existence. He was postured in the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody. He was already postured in what was yet to come, the resurrection. See, David was at a place in his childlike a posturing where he could look and see God. And he started that psalm by saying, oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. In other words, the glory of God reaches from boundary to boundary. He said it like this in verse 2. Out of the mouths of babes and suckling has thou ordained strength because of thine enemies. What is he saying? Never have I seen the righteous forsaken, neither their seed begging for bread. God is keeping our children, come on somebody, that thou mightest still, watch this, that you might still shut down the enemy. Listen, my beloved, it doesn't matter if God sent it or God allowed it. What's important is that God is using it. And God is using it to shut the devil up. Come on, somebody. And open up the church's mouth so that we can begin to speak loudly. Watch this. God is saying, I'm tired of the church. More concerned. And I ain't talking about nobody. We say, I'm tired of the church. My church. Nothing wrong with growth, but it's where your heart is that God's concerned with. He said, my church is turning into mega wonders instead of Messiah wonders. We begun to allow people dictate the prophet. I give a word to the man or woman of God, and it's got to be filtered through how the people that I've sent you to establish correction in. We even got so many ministers now that we got ministerial groups whose purpose is to keep the pastor straight, to tell him what he can do or can't do. God says some of that might be good, but everything ain't God. Come on, somebody. You cannot allow people to alter what I'm saying to you, church. We got to speak Jesus Christ that people can be set free. In the fourth chapter, in the seventh chapter of the book of Zechariah, in the fourth year of King Darius's reign, the Lord came to Zechariah, watch this, and he spake to the land. He told him, he said, speak to the land and to the priests and ask them, when you fast, when you mourned, hear me, did you at all fast unto me? Or are you just doing church? He says, when you ate and when you drank, did you not eat and drink to yourselves? He said, did you hear the words that I spoke to the former prophets? And he gave him instruction. It's basically saying, help the poor, help the brokenhearted, mend fences, give sight to the blind, speak, oh God, he's saying, speak the acceptable year of the Lord Jesus Christ. God said, did you hear my instruction? And they did not do it. And man, watch this. The prophets begin to cry out. And the people begin to cry out. Does this sound familiar? What are we crying out about? Are we crying out of our disobedience? Do we want to know what God is using this time for? Or are we just trying to hide behind what we call faith now because we're in a battle that we don't understand? Is this a mission or is it truly reconciliation that we want? Are we really seeking after God? Because God is saying, because we're not here, he is not hearing. God is telling his church, I need you to listen. As I continue to hear from Habakkuk, he said, while you sit and while you wait to see, he said, remember this. I need you to write the vision that my son came, died on the cross, spent a weekend in dust in the grave. But don't stop there. Remember that he got up and that he came for you. God is saying and telling us right now, he says, we're expecting the church, to run when we ain't making it plain. Jesus said, watch this. Through the inspiration of Joshua in the book, the 24th chapter, he says, if you see it to be evil to serve God, he said, choose the day. You want to be a part of the group that causes this, the endemic? Or you want to continue to run around about the pandemic? I don't know about you, but I choose God. I want to serve him. This ain't no ordinary worship. This is a season when we got to tear down tradition and lift up the name of Jesus. Yes, we got to follow instruction, but our faith walk still has to be strong. God told me to leave you with these three things as I close. The first is don't miss the signs. Don't let these times fool you, church. He said, in these times obtain wisdom. James 1:5 says, if you lack it, just ask God. He said, in all of your getting, get understanding. Why? Because he give it to men liberally. Oh God, I'm telling you. He says, happy is the man in Proverbs, the 3rd chapter. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom and the man that getteth understanding. Why, my beloved? Because of this. Simply put, wisdom is what makes intellect grow. It's what makes intellect grow. The second thing is that, watch this now, we have to seek and obtain his favor. The Bible talks about how Jesus went down with them and came to Nazareth in the second chapter of Luke, around the 51st verse. And he said, and he was subject unto them. He submitted to them. Watch this. But his mother kept all the things that he had said and that was being said in her heart. And watch this, because we keep the word in our heart, it says Jesus, he increased in that wisdom and stature, hear me, and in favor and God, with God and man. Beloved, stick with God. Keep his word in your heart so that what's in a man is what he is. What's in his heart is what he thinks. So during these trying times, you're thinking God is above everything. And finally, he says, obtain charity. It's a gift. It says, listen, as a man is purposed in his heart, here it is again. Let him give, not grudgingly. Stop complaining. Don't just do it because you're supposed to be a member of the church. Do it because God loves you for doing it. My beloved, God said, what manner of man are you that he's mindful of you? You are the manner of man that he has always had on his mind. Give God a chance in this time so he can give us a chance to end these times as they are. We give God all the glory, the honor, and the praise in his head this time, this Easter Sunday, that we want to ask. Have you been moved by the word? Whatever God has said to you during our period of time together, has it caused you to cry out, God, help me? God has made a way for us. He said, if you just believe in your heart and confess it with your mouth, you shall be saved. You shall be covered. If that's you today, beloved, God is saying, now is your time. Pick me up, not tradition. Open up your heart to me and allow me to come in and sup. He said, pick up my yoke. He said, my burden is light. God is asking you today, will you be his? Will you submit to him? Just ask God to fill you up until you overflow so you can make your life plain and run with it. We thank you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Happy Easter. Realize that this too shall pass.